birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky.
I'm gonna click start webinar.
Fantastic. Good luck, everyone.
Thank you.
It's a new dawn. It's a new welcome, everyone.
It's a new life for me. Yeah, it's a new dawn.
Hello.
It's a new life for me.
I see folks trickling in. This is DC for Democracy's At Large Candidate Forum. We're going to give everyone about 1 minute to get logged on, and then we'll get started. Please introduce yourself in the chat. Feel free to share your name, your ward, anything else that you'd like to share with everyone.
Butterflies are having fun, you know what I mean.
And we'll go ahead and get started. We're going to begin promptly this evening. As I mentioned, please feel free to introduce yourself in the chat with your ward, where you're calling in from, how you're doing this evening. And we're very, very happy to have everyone here with us. My name is Alex Dodds. I'm the chair of DC for Democracy, and I'm very glad to welcome everyone here tonight for our forum with the candidates for DC Council Member at Large. Before anything else, I'd like to introduce DC for Democracy. And I'm going to do that with the help of a slide deck. DC for Democracy is an all-volunteer political organization that advocates for policies and candidates that make DC communities more inclusive, democratic, and just. We are a membership organization, and anyone is welcome to become a member and attend our meetups, our forums like this, and join our working groups. You can learn more at dc4democracy.org. We are incredibly excited to have several of the at-large council candidates with us tonight. Fred Hill, Karim D. Marshall, Kenyan McDuffie, Graham McLaughlin, Giuseppe Niosi, David Schwartzman, and Elissa Silverman. We're gonna hear from all of them in just a bit. I'd also like to extend a warm welcome to Kimberly Perry, the Executive Director of DC Action, who is joining us this evening as our moderator. Kim has facilitated other forums with DC for Democracy in the past, and I think everyone is in for a wonderful time this evening. Kim, we're incredibly glad to have you back with us. If you are sharing or posting about this forum on social media, please use the hashtag DC4D at large to keep track of the forum conversation. You can also tag us. We are at DC4D, the number four, on Facebook and Twitter. Let me see what else is on our agenda. This forum is best viewed in gallery view. That should be the default if you're watching this on a desktop computer, but there will be a particular part of the program this evening where you'll want to be able to see all of the candidates at once. So if you typically use speaker view, feel free to switch back to gallery view at the lightning round. I'm telling you that now so that if you need a few minutes to figure out exactly how to make that work, you can take that time now. Typically, it's in the top right corner of your screen. There's an option called View. DC4D members and supporters submitted the questions on tonight's program. You'll hear from a few supporters directly through video, but all of the questions that you'll hear this evening are based on what we heard from our members. This is the first time that we put out an open call for questions and have really formulated the agenda based on what we heard from members and voters in DC. This is also a unique race. Unlike some of the past forums that we have hosted, DC voters will vote for two members, at-large members of the council. And so as you're listening tonight, we encourage you to keep that in mind. Captions are enabled on tonight's event. And if you need closed captioning, that should be at the bottom of your screen. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Kim Perry to lead us through tonight's event.
Thanks, Alex. I appreciate it. Good evening, everyone. I'm so glad you guys are with us. I'm really pleased to be with you again. It's such an important evening. It's an exploration and fact-finding mission of where our at-large candidates stand on issues that really matter in our everyday lives. I'm really enthusiastic about so many of you who are attending. The numbers are rolling. So excited that so many people decided to share their evening with us. We've got seven candidates this evening and only 90 minutes, so I think we should jump right in. Let's start with some of our ground rules for the evening. Alex, is there a slide for ground rules?
There totally
is. I'm happy to just sort of review them.
Yes.
The first is, as Alex mentioned, all of the questions were developed by members of DC for Democracy, even the video questions that you all see. So we've got a combination tonight of long form questions. We've got lightning round questions, and then we come back to some long form questions. And included in those will be your opening statements, candidates, as well as your closing remarks. It'll go really fast. The questions will all be addressed to, or every single question will be addressed to every single candidate. And the order of answers or responses will be rotated. So it'll change every time. Each question will specify a time limit for the answer. So some of the questions allow a 90-second response, and some questions require just a 1-minute response. And then of course, when we do the lightning round, remember you're just gonna be doing thumbs up or thumbs down. Time limits are going to be strictly enforced. We have seven candidates, and so we really need to be respectful of time. I know that won't be a problem for any of you. And we do have our digital clock with us this evening that will assist us in making sure that we all stay on time. For those of you in the audience as attendees, please remember to use the chat. I see you already have been, but just remember to keep all that engagement nice and respectful. We like the healthy debate, but we wanna make sure that we are expressing care and kindness and respect to each and all of our candidates. So with that, why don't we just jump right in and get started. Our first question is a long form opener question. And so please share with us your experiences and the roles in your personal life that connect to DC for Democracy's ideals of justice, equity, and a voice for all. For this question, you have 90 seconds, and we're gonna start with Mr. Hill.
There we go. Can you hear me? All right. Thank you so much. My name is Fred Hill. I'm a successful business owner for 25 years here in the district. I have hired over 500 DC residents and 180 returning citizens. So building a workforce is second nature to me right now. I'm also a veteran, a father, and a grandfather. Some of the things that I've done throughout the city for the last 7 years is that when we discovered that there were more people having challenges getting to good quality foods for as a result of the food deserts across the city or in certain areas of the city, we went to carry those goods to all of our seniors, single parents, every single Sunday, and I've been doing that for 7 years. So this is one of the things that also introduced me into the needs of the people here in the city. That led to areas like housing, unaffordable housing, policing, public safety matters. And then when we look at our school system, how it's being played as a pawn right now in many of the needs of our children and our school teachers. So I intend to be one of those candidates that definitely will show you I have the experience, the know-how, and the change to make city life better for everyone here in the district. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Mr. Marshall.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us, and thank you to Ms. Perry and DC for Democracy for putting this together. My name is Karim D. Marshall, and I am running to be your next at-large DC council member. The reason I'm running is really simple. I think we have a council who hasn't actually met its actual responsibility in being able to take care of being an effective oversight organ or being able to thoughtfully produce legislation that makes your lives better. Now, I'm a third generation Washingtonian, a father, and a parent of a two-year-old. One of the things that's on the horizon for us is trying to figure out where we're going to send our daughter when she turns three. The fact that we have to go through a lottery, that we're relying solely on random chance to determine whether or not our children are able to get an adequately resourced education, is horrifying to me. I understand that the thought was to try to make things fair, but all it's really done is force people who live where I live, east of the river, to try to figure out how to get their kids into a school that's on the other side of the city. That's not equity, that's not justice, that's not fairness. Now, as we move forward as a council, we have a responsibility, particularly as we face going into a difficult economic climate, to be making very smart, deliberative, and thoughtful decisions about how we spend your money to make lives better for the rest of our residents. I have 12 years of government experience. I know what the government does well and what it doesn't do well. And if you put me on the council, I'll make sure that the next 4 years are better than they were before. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember McDuffie.
Good evening and thank you to everyone. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here with you this evening. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Kenyan McDuffie, and for the last 10 years, I've had the honor of representing Ward 5 on the Council of the District of Columbia. Before serving on the Council of the District of Columbia, I served in a myriad of roles as civil rights attorney for the United States Department of Justice, as a prosecutor in Prince George's County. I've worked with Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton, our warrior on the Hill, which really led to my passion to serve the community across District of Columbia, but particularly here in my own neighborhood and stronghold, where I was raised and where I call home to this day with my wife and my two daughters. In fact, I live in the same house, and I'm seated in the same house where I grew up that my grandparents bought back in 1952. But I gotta tell you, growing up in DC during the 1980s, 1990s, when our city was plagued by violence and really a lack of opportunity, was tough. And so my life honestly could have gone in any number of directions. But I was one of the fortunate ones in my neighborhood. I attended high school and graduated from Woodrow Wilson High School, which is now Jackson Reed. But the reality is I struggled after high school with two unsuccessful stints at UDC, unable to find a job, and really was an opportunity that came to me in the form of a job carrying mail for the United States Postal Service that literally changed my life and put me on a trajectory that allowed me to save up enough money, go back to UDC for the third time, graduate from Howard, and become the first male in my family to graduate from college.
Thank you, Councilmember McDuffie.
I thought we had 90 seconds.
It was 90 seconds.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Kim.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Well, thanks to everyone for taking your evening to join us. And Kim, thanks for hosting and a fitting question with all the work that you do at DC Action about opportunity and equity for all. So the question was, what do you do in your personal life to really push that and further it? So on the professional side, I lead a health equity program that impacts over 100 million people annually. And I bring the number up because I think we need individuals who are fluent with large budgets and significant scaled impact when we're thinking about council and the $19.5 billion budget that we have. In my personal life, I opened my home to guys coming home from prison for about a decade, and together we built intentional community. From an educational equity standpoint, I personally mentored two boys in DC for 8 years and have been a CASA for foster youth, and have also been on the board of literacy organizations and educational advocacy organizations pushing for equity and broader out-of-school time and other supports. And then on the economic equity standpoint, I've helped a number of formerly incarcerated men and women to launch their own businesses, which have built wealth for themselves, but they also hire 40 DC residents. And then lastly, I serve on the board of 1863 Ventures, which works with Black and women-owned businesses to end the venture capital gap and to provide accelerator support to grow those businesses.
Thank you so much. Mr. Niosi.
Good evening. Thank you very much for hosting the event. I'm grateful for having the opportunity to make my case for you. I am a husband, a artist, an engineer, a naval reserve officer, and a gentleman. But most importantly, I'm a native third generation homegrown Ward 5 Washingtonian. And the love for my city runs deep. I'm running on a platform that represents pretty much everyone in Washington, D.C., public safety, education, and fiscal responsibility. We all believe that we should feel safe in our homes and our communities. We feel safe coming home from, you know, our nightly, you know, having fun at the local restaurant. And I believe that our public safety and are preventing violence at its root. I believe that our children deserve the best education and that our parents know exactly what our children need. And I also am an avid supporter of trade schools. And I believe that we should have a robust, strong local economy with our, you know, incentives for small and local businesses. As a leader hand-selected by Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton to attend the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy, I have already been representing Washington, D.C. on the national scale, and I've learned to set an example where actions speak louder than words, and I intend to continue setting an example by bringing accountability, responsibility, hard work, and integrity to the Wilson Building. Yeah, I've been door knocking in all eight wards. I've been listening, most importantly, listening to voters to ensure that their voices are being heard throughout this process.
Thank you so much. Mr. Schwartzman.
Good evening. I'm a retired Howard University professor, a climate scientist, and a human rights activist. I first ran for office in 1998 and several times since. And my priority then and now is the elimination of child poverty in our nation's first human rights city, an achievable goal given our more than ample tax base. For more than 20 years, I've advocated for a progressive DC tax structure for more taxes paid by wealthy residents. Last summer, the people of DC won a big victory towards this goal with a historic rejection of the agenda of the lobby of the big corporate sector, the Federal City Council, a rejection of trickle-down economics, which has driven the shockingly high racial and economic disparities in our community. I'm going to skip over to keep the 90 seconds. As a result, low-income workers will get a big increase in their DC earned income tax credit. More homeless will be housed and so on. Now we have the opportunity for our local government to move to a much more just and equitable DC. Please consider casting one of your two votes for council at large for me, and I will use the full resources of my office for the many, not the few.
Thank you so much. Councilmember Silverman.
Good evening, Kim. Great to see you. Good evening to my fellow candidates, to DC4D. So for those who don't know me, I'm Elissa Silverman. This is my second term as one of your two at-large independent council members. And tonight I'm asking for at least one of your votes to return for a third term. So your question, Kim, was about the personal connection between DC4D's agenda of social justice, fairness, and equity. And I'll say that began for me when I went to public schools in Baltimore in the 80s, at a time when most middle-class families, Black and white, were abandoning the public school system. And I saw what a difference a good teacher makes. I'm still connected to my classmates who were all in Mrs. Sims' class, a teacher who knew that we all came from different backgrounds and had different lived experiences, but she treated each one of us respectfully and saw that we could achieve our potential. Look, DC4D, we've been allies on a lot of things, but I think the thing that really we're aligned on is most strongly is the corrupting power of money in politics. We have fought, starting in 2012, we fought the good fight on Initiative 70. We lost that one, but I think we're winning the larger battle.
Thank you so much. Let's head right into our next question. The district has extreme levels of income and wealth inequality, with the average white household having 81 times the wealth of the average Black household. Addressing this will require sustained and large-scale investments in housing, in education, job training, healthcare, and a host of other needs in communities that have been historically exploited. What do you see as the way forward to make these sustained large-scale investments? You have 90 seconds to respond, and we will begin first with Mr. Marshall.
So it sounds like we're talking about both education and housing. And I think there's a couple of things that we need to say at the outset. Part of the challenge that we have as a government is that we've been too reactive over the last 20 years. We always knew that the plan in order to get our fiscal house back in order required DC to grow to about 700,000 residents. And now that we're there, we're looking at a situation with feigned surprise. Like, we didn't build enough houses for 700,000 people, and now we're in the middle of a blitz to try to close that gap as quickly as possible. And I'll give the executive credit for doing as much as they can with the resources that they have. But in order for this to really be fixed, we actually need to have a concerted effort from both the council and the executive to come up with a long-term economic development strategy. That's been absent. We haven't had that in the last two administrations, or the last two cycles. So I think what the first thing we can do is, in order to fix this, is to have a general economic strategy for the district as a whole that both the legislature and the executive have worked together and agreed on, and has also gotten the buy-in of the most affected communities, particularly those where I live east of the river. We talk about unemployment numbers and we talk about wealth gaps, but the true unemployment number, not just the number of people who are looking for jobs, but the true unemployment numbers, the gap between the working age folks and the folks who are employed east of the river, is more like 44% and 37% respectively. So if we want to be honest about fixing some of these problems, we have to be honest about the conversations that we're having. And that starts with getting our government to work together consistently.
Thank you so much, Mr. McDuffie.
Oh, that's a really important question. I think education obviously is important to our schools. When I got elected in Ward 5, Ward 5 didn't have a middle school at the time. I worked really hard to protect funding and make sure that we can open up Brookland Middle School, open up McKinley Tech Middle School. But we have to recognize that education doesn't simply occur inside of schools as well. It happens in our recreation centers. It happens in communities across District of Columbia where people can gather. And it has to happen in a safe environment. One of the things that I focused on is making sure that communities are safe through my work, both with the NEAR Act, ushering in a public health-based approach to crime prevention and intervention in the District of Columbia, but also making sure that they're programming throughout rec centers in Ward 5 to create an environment where we can have intergenerational learning that occurs with our young folks, as well as our seniors and everybody in between. But I also think we have to be bold. We can't keep doing the same thing over and over again expecting a different result. It's one of the reasons why I authored a baby bonds program that was supported by my colleagues and at the council to the tune of $32 million to help close the one of the widest racial wealth gaps of any city in the country here in the District of Columbia. Putting $1,000 in a trust fund for babies born in the poverty in the District of Columbia can be transformational. And we've got to be able to do things like that to be able to close the racial wealth gap and really give people a fighting chance to stay in this city. We've seen far too many Black residents pushed out of the District of Columbia, and I've been fighting for a racial equity agenda for the last several years.
Thank you so much, Mr. McLaughlin.
Just put in the chat that we have a Ward 8 economic development strategy, and why don't we scale that across the city? And I think that brings up a really important point, which is, for years, from a government standpoint, DC government, federally, et cetera, we have created policy by a few that is put on the many. It's been years of historical structural racism that has disinvested in particular communities and has created that wealth gap. And we're perpetuating that in DC by continuing not to invest in, fund, and support from resident and citizen-driven initiatives. One of the things that I think we can do much more effectively is ensure that we are listening, we are supporting, and we are scaling up being able to support those types of efforts. Secondly, from an education standpoint, and you know, it's an all strategy, not one specific thing, but I think we fund the bursts that three act. We engage in high impact tutoring in second grade when kids are transitioning from learning to read to reading to learn. And we begin to give every kid in DC school systems a pathway post-graduation, whether that's college, whether that's vocational, whether that's apprenticeships. And as we think about housing, we think about increased production in some of the ways that Karim and others talked about, but also preservation to ensure that we're expanding affordable housing in ways that we can align to the number one wealth creator in this country, which is home ownership, not just renting.
Thank you, Mr. Niosi.
Thank you for the question. This is certainly a question that there needs to be a lot of nuance because there's no just one band-aid fix to actually fix this. There's no equity without better education, better public safety, and a robust economy. Now, things that I support and having spoken with members of the community as I've been door knocking have included, we do need technical development skill training and trade schools to make sure that people have a path forward to start bridging that wealth gap. And as Graham was saying, you know, I believe that we should be having incentive programs for people to root themselves into community by buying and purchasing houses. I think that we have a great first-time homebuyer organization, and I think that can be expanded upon. But lastly, you know, having done some ride-alongs with our local law enforcement, you know, I found that part of the issue is community policing, and our police are just underfunded and understaffed. And so, you know, imagine being a child in a community where you're actually fearing for your life every single day and not focusing on your education. I think that all of these things go hand in hand to make a more prosperous society for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Schwartzman.
Yes, a critical question. I point viewers to my article in the DC line on a revisiting the Green New Deal for DC. And highest in my priority is eliminating child poverty. And I was a champion in the Fair Budget Coalition to launch a demand for raising the TANF income support to the highest national level, which is actually white kids in New Hampshire. And that would cost about $68 million fully implemented. So where is the money going to come from? Well, we should do the same thing we did with wealthy residents, recover the federal tax cut from the big corporate developer sector. And so hike their taxes. They should be paying more. We should shift subsidies from market rate housing to create social housing and community land trusts. A social housing would keep household income for housing at 30% of income, which would allow residents to save money and buy homes. There's a model in Vienna that shows that's true. So those are some of the remedies that should be implemented.
Thank you so much. Ms. Silverman.
Kim, I think we need to take advantage of our own economy. We need to create a pipeline for our residents so that they can get the good paying jobs in our key industry sectors. I'll just give a quick example. When we handed out the vaccine, the COVID vaccine in the first round, 3 out of 4 doses went to non-district residents. We have some low-hanging fruit here, which is getting our residents into healthcare sector jobs, IT jobs, infrastructure jobs, jobs that require a commercial driver's license. And that's what my committee has funded. You want to get a bachelor's of science in nursing at UDC? We funded it and you'll go for free. We need our residents, particularly Black residents, to earn good salaries, to get good jobs so they can afford to live here. And that's the key, I think, to closing the equity gap. So let's make sure that district residents, through creating these pipelines. And this is what I've done in my committee, again, created something called the Healthcare Sector Workforce Partnership, which is working with our hospitals, our biggest employers, to make sure that DC residents, our residents, get the jobs at the new hospitals, nursing jobs, IT jobs, good paying jobs in which you can afford to live in this city.
Thank you so much. And final response to this question, Mr. Hill.
Thank you so much. First thing we need to remember is that DC is rated number 41 out of 51 states when we talk about our public school system. Our public schools years ago used to provide the trades to those residents, which helped build middle-class American or African-American families, people of color here in the district. As soon, not a short time, but as soon as Marion Barry passed, who fought to have the Section 3 rule, which says that in any government-funded construction project, that 61% of the people from that community must be working on that project, they eliminated that opportunity, which has sped up the number of people who haven't had that equal opportunity across this city to make money. Not everyone wants to go to college, and neither should they have to in order to make a decent salary. Again, when we look at our schools, we have agencies and we have government leadership right now that's not even making sure the schools are safe for our kids to return. Not all of them, but some of them are getting the dollars, the investment, the time of our leadership. We need to make sure that we have people who are going to stand there and hold them accountable. And that's what I intend to do as the next council at large. It makes no sense that we go through this year after year after year with the same people expecting a different result. That is absolutely insane. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Our next question. DC for Democracy has endorsed the Safe and Free DC, a Black-led legislative agenda for community safety. Our partners at DC Justice Lab lead this work, and our next question comes directly from one of their staff members, Nikkei Savain. This is going to be a video. When the video is complete, you each will have 1 minute to respond. And let's try it again, Alex. We just can't hear the audio.
Sorry about that. Give me 1 minute.
Yep, no worries. I'll just reiterate after the video, it'll be a 1 minute response, and we're going to start with Mr. McDuffie. Oh, no. Still no audio.
Good evening. With the near constant media coverage of crime, understanding your vision for the future of public safety is essential. On one hand, the Police Reform Commission drafted numerous recommendations for decentering the police, including shifting responsibilities to and heavily investing in community-based resources, holding police officers accountable for misconduct, and decreasing the size of the force. On the other hand, Mayor Bowser recently requested to increase the size of the force, and the council approved funding for significant hiring bonuses for new recruits. What are your priorities for making DC safer? And specifically, what would you do to ensure that all residents, especially the most marginalized, feel safe? Thank you.
I hope you all were able to hear that audio. The final question was, what are your ideas for improving community safety? And we'll begin first with Mr. McDuffie.
Thank you for the question. I think public safety, crime and violence is on top of everybody's mind, no matter where you go in the District of Columbia, whether you're in Ward 1 or Ward 8, which is why when I chaired the Judiciary Committee, I decided to do something about it. I brought a cross-sector of people and organizations to the table when I authored and passed the NEAR Act, which is a holistic approach to preventing crime and really putting resources into a public health-based approach to crime prevention and intervention. It has 20 titles and subtitles. I know folks on this call have heard about it, but we've got to double down on the work. We can't have a safe community in this city without emphasizing accountability and opportunity, both. We need to make sure that people that commit crimes are held accountable for what they do and that there are consequences and justice for victims and the community as a victim. But we cannot simply focus on law enforcement. We have to focus on the opportunity side of the equation, which is why I've done so much to make sure we have programs like the Pathways Program that put people in a structured setting to make sure they get the resource, job training they need to change their life, much like my life was changed when I got an opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. McDuffie. And just a reminder to all the candidates, this time it's just a 1 minute response, so a tad bit shorter. Mr. McLaughlin, you are up next, followed by Mr. Niosi.
On my last question, I talked about how we need to make policy informed by the community. So I'm going to talk about a couple of ways I would do that. 2 weeks ago, I was on a call with the Chief of Police Trigger Project and a number of youth in the community who were talking about their solutions. I have worked, or I've volunteered at YSC, the Juvenile Detention Center, have lived in intentional community with returning citizens, have also talked with behavioral health professionals, law enforcement officers, et cetera. We talk a lot about holding individuals. We talk a lot about accountability overall. I do think we need accountability across the board. That begins with a social contract that, you know, any child who is in this city has the support of universal childcare, has a great education, et cetera. As we think about public safety, I do think we need an adequate force to hold people accountable if they are hurting others. I do think we need to prosecute and incarcerate, but I think we need to rethink jail to be a therapeutic experience and more effective for reentry. There's a lot more on that, but in a minute, that's where I'll stop.
Thank you so much, Mr. Niosi.
Thank you for the question. I think first and foremost, our council has been unresponsive with a lot of the rampant crime that we've seen. You know, we're at record highs right now. One of the things that I've been actively doing is, you know, between door knocking in the communities, I've also done ride-alongs with our police force, and I've learned firsthand like what they see on the front lines. And I could tell you, you know, it's very much an understaffing issue, very much a funding issue, and a very much a, you know, antiquated technology issue with, you know, some of their computer systems. And you know, as a council member, I want to make sure that we have the best trained police force, the best, culturally adaptive and agile police force. And I think that's important. But I also think that we need to ensure that we have community policing and that we are communicating properly with our various communities across all 8 wards in Washington, D.C. So that's sort of the, you know, again, these all take nuance for the question, but yeah, I think that's where, you know, a good start for that.
Mr. Schwartzman.
First of all, I support the agenda of defund MPD and refund our communities. And we should, of course, fully implement the NEAR Act, including the recommendation to DC auditor recommended, which was to have an Office of Violence Prevention and Health Equity within DC Health. Further, we should have a civilian police review board that has subpoena power that's elected, because we need to hold the police accountable for their harassment of Black youth and even the killing of Black youth that has occurred off too often. And finally, we should have, of course, community control of the police and treat violence as a public health issue.
Thank you, Mr. Hill, and then Mr. Marshall. Oh, excuse me. Oh my goodness. Ms. Silverman, you're up next, and then Mr. Hill will follow.
Thanks, tough being the only woman here, along with you, Kim. So here's my approach. We need to implement the recommendations of the Police Reform Commission. I have a lot of respect for the commissioners and their work. I think a lot of what the commissioners looked at is how do we build trust, especially in marginalized communities. I think one of the recommendations is something that I believe was unfunded from the NEAR Act, which is pairing behavioral health specialists, taking the public health approach. That's the right approach, pairing behavioral health specialists with MPD. The Police Reform Commission also addresses traffic safety. Let's take traffic enforcement out of the hands of MPD and give it to DDOT so we can make our streets safer.
Thank you for that. Mr. Hill and then Mr. Marshall.
Thank you. We must not forget what got us in this place, what got us here in the first place. And that is a council that unanimously decided to defund our police department, which destroyed the morale of many of the good officers we do have on the force or did have on the force. We lost 1,300 officers before COVID came about. And as a result, we've put the city in a bad place. So the first thing we need to do is we need to raise the pay by 30% to officers, to our fire emergency staff, to our school staff, and our sanitation workers, who are all grossly underpaid for the work that they do. The other thing that we need to do is we need to get out of this belief that we're going to have a violence interrupter call when the guns are going off. When the guns are going off, nobody's dialing love, peace, or understanding. They're all dialing 911. And if you don't have the officers and those first responders that can come to remove the threat, we're going to be in worse shape than what we are right now.
And finally, Mr. Marshall, you're up. Yeah.
Okay, so the first thing we have to acknowledge is that people are legitimately afraid. Now, the question is, do we give them answers that give them hope, or do we play into their fear in the hopes that they vote for us? I prefer to give you information and help you make decisions so that we can actually have a better future as opposed to just playing on your fears. So I'll say this, we have a lack of coordination problem. The fact that the council convened a police reform commission and then did not implement the recommendations of that commission, and then the mayor subsequently created her own commission, is an indicator of the fact that our government is not particularly well coordinated. We need people with lower egos who are willing to work together to try to serve all of our residents. Secondarily, we need to talk about the fact that in order to truly destroy crime, you have to destroy the parents of crime. You have to eliminate poverty. You have to eliminate depravity. You have to eliminate the fact that if somebody doesn't see a future for themselves, they're more willing to commit a crime. And then finally, the juvenile justice system is supposed to be rehabilitative. If we arrest a child, put him on a monitor, and then throw him back into the environment that led him to crime, he's more likely to commit another crime. We have to focus on rehabilitating as opposed to just putting people under monitoring.
Thank you, Mr. Marshall. And that was your time. And that was the end of that particular question. The chat is on fire, you guys. Wow, we thought there might be people would take some time to warm up. That is not the case. So let's continue to jump in. This next long form question is going to have a minute response. We're going to start first with Mr. McLaughlin, followed by Mr. Niosi. And the question for each of you candidates is this. Everyone agrees that domestic workers should not be subject to human rights violations. Yet here in the district, domestic workers, including house cleaners, nannies, our home care workers, who all provide essential support in homes, are excluded from the district's human rights law. The Domestic Worker Employment Rights Amendment Act is a piece of legislation currently before the DC Council that would finally end this loophole. How have you supported this legislation? And what specific actions would you take to enact this needed reform? Again, 1 minute for each of you, and we'll start first with Mr. McLaughlin.
I think on pending legislation, it is hard for a non-sitting council member to talk through how they have supported and how they have pushed it through. I certainly am supportive of it, and I think this speaks to an issue of how are we thinking about creative solutions to support opportunities in the economy to provide greater pathways to family sustaining wages. So for instance, talking about home health aides specifically, one of the things that I think we could do really effectively is be able to increase our Medicaid reimbursement rates for home health aides so that we could unlock some Medicaid and Medicare funding to be able to create pathways to support senior citizens and others with home health aides and create pathways to better careers as well. So I very heartily support the Domestic Workers Bill of Rights, would do everything in my power on council to support its passage, and would be a strong supporter.
Thanks so much for that. Mr. Niosi.
Thank you for the question. And to echo what Graham McLaughlin was saying, it is very difficult to embody sort of what is actually currently happening on the council with hypothetical questions. However, I certainly support a stronger, more robust economy so the people can find the avenues to get what they are actually kind of looking for. Now, I think that we really need some community building and for people to be rooted in our community. And if that is ensuring that they have the right technical development, ensuring that they have the right medical needs, and everything needs to be taken with compassion and empathy to ensure that they are living a dignified existence. And so, I would support something like this, but again, it's very nuanced because I'm not a sitting council member. Thank you.
Forgive me, Mr. Schwartzman.
Yes, this is a very critically important bill. I already testified in support to the council. And let me say this, the Human Rights Commission needs to get adequate resources to do its job. It's underfunded, it doesn't have enough staff, and therefore a lot of complaints are not addressed in a quick fashion. Once elected, of course, I'm going to use my office and my salary, because I have a pension and Social Security, I don't need a salary. I will use my office and salary to organize in collaboration with the groups that are fighting for human rights in the district. My office will be a resource center for that struggle.
Thank you so much for that. Appreciate it. And just want to clarify, clearly, if you're not a sitting member of the council, you can't answer from that perspective. So please just answer as you can. Ms. Silverman.
Thank you, Kim. The Domestic Workers Employment Rights Act is a bill I introduced. So I want to thank Graham for his support. I want to thank David for testifying. Over 90 witnesses testified. And here's what it is. It's very simple. Right now, domestic workers, people who work in the home, who are overwhelmingly women of color, don't have the same rights that you and I have working outside the home. And so what this bill does is give these women, largely, who take care of our kids, take care of our aging parents, the right to a contract, to understand, to have a level playing field with their employer, a right of action if there are issues at the workplace. But it's run into peril because it was about to be marked up, and then all of a sudden it was triple referred. Which means it was sent to three committees instead of just mine. I plan on marking it up next week. I know.
Elissa, we lost your audio.
Oh, sorry about that. My apologies. This is a really important bill, and I'm thrilled to have everyone support the bill. I don't know how much time I have, Kim.
Why don't you take just 5 more seconds, since we lost just a little bit of your audio, and then we'll continue.
I will just say the bill's in peril right now because from some political shenanigans, it was triple referred. It was referred out of my committee to three committees. And we really need this bill passed to give these women fairness and dignity in the workplace.
Thank you. Mr. Hill and then Mr. Marshall.
Okay, thank you so much. I definitely would support it. I also would like to say, along with that, is that there are other people outside that are still dealing with the same issues that don't have that support. I would make sure that, one, we have our elected officials that sit beside me understand that this should not be a one-way deal. This should be a consideration of all people that need that kind of assistance, not just one. And that's pretty much my position on it. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Mr. Marshall, and then Mr. McDuffie.
Can I get Fred's last 30 seconds? So I think the important thing to remember about these types of these jobs and this discrimination associated with it is that it has its roots in Jim Crow. When you think about the lower work protection standards for domestic workers, for farm workers, for tip workers, this is all a result of the fact that after slavery was legally ended, the institutional structures were adjusted in ways to continue to oppress those types of employees because they were overwhelmingly Black employees. So we're dealing with the legacy of institutionalized racism when we talk about the disparate treatment between certain types of jobs. So the most important thing we have to do is be honest. I come from an equity background. You have to lead with honesty. This is the history we're dealing with. So the most important thing I want to talk about with this is that part of the challenge that we have on the council right now is that we have a chairman that exercises disproportionate power because the members don't actually know the rules well enough to force a re-referral of a bill. So part of the job is being able to convince your council members, but part of it is also being able to know who you're dealing with and being able to work the rules in a way to make sure that your bills move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Marshall. Mr. McDuffie.
Thank you. This indeed is an extraordinarily important bill. And as has been mentioned, it has its roots and a history of racism, slavery, de jure, de facto segregation in the United States. And in fact, it still is a measure that largely impacts people of color and women. It's one of the reasons why I co-introduced the measure. And though maybe there was an intent to imperil the bill, I know when we get back from recess, it's gonna be marked up, I think, in two committees. And at some point it comes to me and I'm gonna deal with the bill because I think the workers deserve it.
Thank you for that. And thanks to each of you candidates for those 1 minute responses. Are you ready for the lightning round? All right. So a little bit of an overview for the lightning round, just to remind you all. First of all, for all of our attendees, this really does work best if your Zoom is in gallery view, because you want to be able to see the frame of each candidate. For you candidates, once the question is read, we will ask you to put a thumbs up in the middle of the screen so that everyone can see if your answer is yes. If your answer is no, it's a thumbs down in the middle of the screen. And if you can just hold it for 10 seconds, so that everyone can sort of see your position. And then I'll have you lower your thumbs and we'll proceed to the next question. Fair?
And it's just yes or no, the only two options, Kim?
Yes or no is the only two options.
What if this complicated?
I mean, this is, yeah.
It's all complicated, but these responses are a yes or a no. All right. Okay, here we go. First question. The minimum wage here in the district is $16.10, but the minimum wage for our tipped workers is only $5.35. Initiative 82 will be on the ballot this November. And if it's passed, it'll increase the tipped minimum wage here in the district. If the measure passes, will you pledge to uphold the will of DC voters and allow it to become law? Thumbs up if you're a yes, thumbs down if you're a no, and please hold it in the middle of the screen. Mr. Hill, oh, there you are. Okay, perfect. Thank you all so much. Second question. Ranked choice voting ensures that candidates are elected to public office with the support of the majority of voters. Do you support ranked choice voting? Thumbs up if yes, thumbs down if no.
I actually disagree with the premise.
Mr. McDuffie, it's a yes or a no, and I see your thumb down.
Well,
Mr. Marshall, you're trying to do the middle of the road.
Conceptually, yes. Conceptually, yes. I have problems with the implementation we've done so far. But conceptually, yes.
All right. Thank you all. Third question. The Reclaim Rent Control platform would make much needed updates to the district's decade-old rent control law, but it's met procedural inertia. As a result, our rent control laws apply only to a handful of units, which all of which are 30 years, I can't talk, all of which are 30 years old or more and remains still full of loopholes. If elected, would you be willing to co-introduce the Reclaim Rent Control platform? Thumbs up if yes, thumbs down if no. If elected, would you be willing to co-introduce the Reclaim Rent Control platform? Yes. Just clarification, or no?
This is their entire platform?
The platform as it is.
Can I add stuff to it?
Down from Mr. McLaughlin. Mr. Marshall and Mr. McDuffie.
If I can add some things. I don't think it goes far enough.
I haven't seen the entire platform yet.
Yeah, I don't think it goes far enough, but sure. It's a good start.
We're going to keep moving. Thank you. Number four, the Local Resident Voting Rights Act, which is currently before the DC Council. It would expand voting rights to local races, to permanent residents and green card holders. Do you support this bill? Thumbs up or thumbs down? Thank you, Mr. Niosi. Okay, Mr. Niosi is a thumbs down. The rest of you thumbs up, thank you for that. Number five, Council Member Charles Allen's Metro for DC proposal would offer $100 each month in Metro fare to every DC resident who applies, and the funds for the program, it funds the program with future surplus revenues, so ahead of other possible surplus uses. We'd like to know whether you support the proposal, and then we want to know if you support its funding source. So two different questions here. So let's start first with, do you support Councilmember Allen's proposal? Thumbs up for yes, thumbs down for no. Thank you very much. Nope, I don't see anything from Ms. Silverman or Mr. McDuffie. Thank you, Ms. Silverman. Mr. McDuffie, where are you?
Vote for nuance. An opportunity to engage and collaborate.
Not a choice. Okay. Second part of the question, do you support the way it's funded? Again, with future surplus revenues. I see a thumbs down from everyone except for Ms. Silverman. Okay, thumbs down from Mr. McDuffie. Thank you all. Next question. In April, Councilmember Janice Lewis-George introduced the Green New Deal for Housing. The bill would create an Office of Social Housing to oversee publicly owned mixed income housing that generates deeper affordability by reinvesting rent payments into lowering costs for tenants and creating more social housing. If elected, would you support this bill? Mr. Schwartzman, I see two thumbs up. We got you. Mr. Hill, Mr. Niosi down. No, Mr. McLaughlin, is that a yes? Ms. Silverman, that's a yes. Mr. McDuffie and Mr. Marshall, where are you?
We haven't even had a hearing. Kim, come on.
Yeah, without being able to mark it up, it's so hard on these.
Yeah. Some of these bills need serious work.
I'm sorry, this is not how I've legislated for 10 years. I mean, it's just not that simple. You're awesome, by the way, Kim. I love your way you moderate, but.
Thank you for that. Let's keep moving. All right, final lightning round here. Rapid rehousing is a short-term subsidy program meant to help individuals experiencing homelessness find affordable permanent housing. Right now, it does not work well here in the district. Many of our families who receive subsidies are unable to afford rent once the subsidies run out. Legislation in the DC Council would alter rapid rehousing so that families unable to afford market rents could transition to permanent housing subsidies. Do you support this? Thumbs up for yes, thumbs down for no. Mr. Hill is a yes. Mr. Marshall is a yes. Mr. Schwartzman is a yes. Mr. McLaughlin, yes. Ms. Silverman, yes. Mr. Niosi, yes. Mr. McDuffie, where are you?
I'm here.
Yes or no?
It's rapid rehousing. Huh? I mean, it is not that simple. Kim, come on, guys. Let's give people something to really know what we're about here. It's not simple as yes or no.
Do we all get to speak to
thanks to you all for putting your thumbs up or your thumbs down. I appreciate it. All right. We've completed that part of the lightning round. Let's keep moving. We're doing great here, you guys.
I'm going to come on board for a moment to say congratulations making it through the lightning round, everyone, and to give our timekeepers a moment to change. I'd like to take this opportunity to shine some thanks and gratitude on the timekeeping team. If you're in the chat, please say thank you to Keish, Jamie, and Keith, who keep us on time this evening. And hopefully that was, yes, a round of thank yous for our timekeeping team. Hopefully that was enough time for you all to get situated. And I'll turn it back to you, Kim.
Yep, sounds good. Video up next. So we're now going to move back into some long, just a few more long form questions. You guys will have 1 minute to respond to these. We'll continue doing the random order. And so our next question is going to come from DC for Democracy member Sharice Muhammad.
Good evening. My name is Sharice Muhammad. I'm a Ward 7 resident with a niece in DC Public Schools, Duke Ellington School of the Arts, my alma mater. My question is for each of the at-large council member candidates. A successful collective bargaining for our teachers of the Washington Teachers Union is critical at this time, where the vacancies in teaching positions, both full-time and substitute teachers, are on the rise. If elected, how would you advocate for our teachers? And what would support look like? Thank you.
Thank you so much. So question is about how you will support our teachers. We'll start first with Mr. Niosi, and then Mr. Schwartzman will follow. Again, remember, you just have 1 minute to respond.
Thank you for the question. Personally, I believe that we should make sure our teachers have the most resources available to them. We should make sure that they are adequately paid and make sure that they have a safe learning environment to teach our children. But I also want to kind of shift the question to recognizing that we want to ensure that all of our facilities where children are learning from have adequate maintenance schedules, and that they our roofs are repaired, our schools are not broken down. Because I think that having a safe learning environment is important for everybody's education. Thank you.
Mr. Schwartzman.
Yes, my office will be will collaborate closely with the Washington Teachers Union. And I have a track record there because I worked for several years with the late Liz Davis to successfully get the Metro Council AFL-CIO to pass a strong resolution in support of hiking the taxes on the wealthy. And I mourn her death. She was a great leader, and I look forward to collaborating with the new leadership of the Washington Teachers Union. I'm very pro-union, and I always have been. And we need more union. We need more union workers' power in this city.
Ms. Silverman, and then Mr. Hill.
Kim, our teachers need a contract. It's been 3 years since our teachers have gotten a contract, and the mayor we need to get a contract so our teachers have fair pay, they get their pay raises, that they have safe working conditions. And if we keep saying that our teachers are critical to our future, if that our education system is critical to our future workforce, economy, to our city, then we need to treat our teachers with dignity and respect and give them a contract. So I actually will be meeting with the teachers union about this. We need to put pressure on the administration to bring a contract forward so that our teachers have some certainty.
Dr. Who?
As I said before, our teachers are grossly underpaid. I will be pushing for a 30% pay raise. Where does this money come from better management of the existing dollars we have? We're almost a $20 billion budget. Right now, our use of the funds, when it goes to our teachers, police department, sanitation workers, and our fire emergency staff, is played with by different leaders. So this will also put them in a position where they can afford to live in the district when you have that kind of a pay. When you're used to a 2 and 4% pay raise, you stay below the cost of living every single year. And we've got to change that by paying people what they're worth and not what we want them to have. And again, I would pull the schools from under the mayor. It needs to be under its own board. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Mr. Marshall.
So one of the advantages of putting me on the council is that I actually have experience in labor law practice. As a practicing attorney, I actually dealt with a lot of this stuff for DPW, so I'm very familiar with labor agreements. Now, I personally believe very strongly that I owe a lot of my success, nearly all of it, to the foundation that my parents gave and to the foundation that was provided by District of Columbia Public Schools. I love teachers. I have an irreconcilable debt with teachers. So I work strong to make sure that they actually have a contract done on time. But some of the things that we need to keep in mind is that teachers make all other jobs possible. First, we can talk about statutorily inserting cost of living adjustments into all of the contracts, because this isn't just the Washington Teachers Union. Theirs is the most egregious example of a contract going over time. But generally, the government as a whole is really bad about making sure that we renegotiate these contracts in a timely fashion. So if the council statutorily inserted cost of living adjustments into all contracts, that would at least deal with the pay issue. And then finally, we need to revisit these no strike clauses.
Thanks so much for that, Mr. McDuffie, and then Mr. McLaughlin.
We need to do whatever we can, really, to make sure that our learning environments across the city are healthy and safe. We know how important it is for teachers to make sure that they have the resources to teach so their kids can learn. And the reality is they do deserve a contract. The reality is the conversations that I've had with people in WTU demonstrate that capacity is thin now, but it was also thin before the pandemic. You look at how many educators we've lost over the last couple of years, and you wonder why the frustration keeps mounting. They deserve a contract, and it's not just simply for the teachers, it's for the substitutes as well, and we need to make sure that we have the resources in place for every person who is contributing to a quality learning environment for our public schools. Our teachers, our substitutes, our counselors, our librarians, to make sure that our educational environment is one where any kid, regardless of their zip code, can thrive.
Thank you so much. Mr. McLaughlin, round us out here.
Yeah, well, I think the question goes really to, you know, how do we provide clarity and support to teachers so that they can support students? And, you know, one is let's ensure that when we're making education policy, it's informed by teachers as well as students, parents, and school staff. I think secondly, we've already talked about it, but clarity on pay, have a contract, know what you're going to have tomorrow, the next day, et cetera. But then also know that you are supported by the city. There are so many retention levers we could be putting in place. We're giving police officers, you know, $20,000 to buy homes. I support that, but I also support that to teachers to be able to support them living in the district, and even going a step further and thinking about zero and low interest loans to be able to purchase homes. I think we can do things with childcare, with public-private partnerships on school property to support them, debt forgiveness, mental health supports, and also stipends to teachers to support their classroom, and being able to hug cats would be the last.
Thank you. You got caught there. Thanks a lot for respecting the time. Really much appreciated. Let's keep moving. Yes. Oops. All right. The Urban Institute says that the district needs an additional 40,000 rental units with rents under $800 a month to meet the needs of DC residents. Please share your top two policy or budget priorities for addressing the district's affordable housing crisis, things that would have the most impact. You have 1 minute for your response. We'll start first with Mr. Schwartzman and then Ms. Silverman.
Well, I've already expressed my priorities. First, of course, we should observe that the DC auditor found that the Housing Production Trust Fund is violated by developers and they don't build low-income units that they're supposed to. That's an immediate thing. But we need to decommodify the supply of housing. Housing is a human right, and therefore we should implement the Green New Deal for Housing bill, which provides for a real beginning of social housing as well as community land trusts. We should know that market rent is not a, rental housing is not affordable to a majority of residents. I have the data to prove that, and it is shocking that this challenge is not being effectively addressed.
Mr. Hill and then Mr. Marshall.
Yeah, Miss. Okay, there you go. The first thing is that we need to make sure that the housing stock is based on a person's income and not the average median income measurement that we see. This keeps a lot of people out because we have the two richest counties in the country that keep those numbers very high. The other thing is, as Mr. Schwartzman mentioned, the developers that are allowed to keep plucking away at the city's budget are the same group of people every single year. And when they come in with an idea of what they're gonna announce to do. They're gonna make it for veterans. They're gonna make it for low income. They're gonna make it for single parents. And then halfway through the deal, there's something that comes out that makes it market rate and no one can afford to stay there. And that's what we need to keep in mind.
Mr. Marshall and then Mr. McDuffie.
So my positions on housing are actually really complicated. So I'm actually gonna invite people to go to my website, marshallfordc.com. Go to the section that talks about housing and there's a lot of information in there. As far as my practical experience, I worked for DMPED for 2 years and the Housing Authority for 6 months. So I understand the way the district in particular does development deals more so than any of the sitting council members and definitely better than any of the other candidates. But there's two things that we can do that are really quick, relatively fast and relatively high impact. First thing is we can actually activate all of the vacant units that are in public housing. In addition to the vacant units in public housing, there are an additional, at least that we know of, at least 10,000 vacant houses in the District of Columbia that could be converted into homes that were available for purchase or sale or rent, depending on how the people who currently own those houses would like to be able to dispose of them. But we need to do some reforms to our probate and transfer laws in order to do that efficiently. And I can help with that.
Mr. McDuffie and then Mr. McLaughlin.
Sure. Look, I live in a home that's been in my family since 1952, and yet the home next door went for $900,000. DC's becoming increasingly unaffordable, which is one of the reasons why I mandated with a bill that got incorporated to the budget that we invest hundreds of millions of dollars into more affordable housing, the Housing Production Trust Fund, whenever we have a surplus, which is one of the reasons why that question was complicated when you asked how to spend the surplus. And so we have to do more of that, but also make sure that the Housing Production Trust Fund is being spent to preserve existing housing, affordable housing, and to produce new units of affordable housing. We also know that the government is the largest landowner, which is one of the reasons why I said whenever we develop the district's land for the purpose of multifamily housing, that we have to set aside some for affordable housing. I did that in a bill. And so I have a track record of delivering results on these very important issues, but we also need to make sure we're protecting tenants' rights in existing affordable units. And so I think we've got to do more clearly to invest in affordable housing to make sure we have units across income levels to the people who are the.
Mr. McLaughlin and then Mr. Niosi.
I think one of the best ways to create affordability as well as to ensure gentrification with justice is to ensure we have more mortgages in the city and we focus significantly on home ownership, not just rentals. The best way to have affordability is to be able to have a home in your family since the 1950s. How do we ensure that others can have that ability to have generational wealth with that house? And how do we build pathways with HPAP, with broadening the Black Home Ownership Fund that the mayor put in recently, et cetera, and has expanded? So one, home ownership, and two is zoning changes, whether that's allowing more 2 and 4 unit, whether that's partnering with houses of worship to be able to change their zoning to create affordable housing on their land. And it's, as Kenyon just talked about, ensuring that our public and quasi-public land is able to be used for affordable housing. A focus on home ownership and a focus on zoning that increases our supply overall and our supply of affordable.
Thank you. And Mr. Niosi, you'll wrap this question.
Thank you for the question. I support incentivizing more density in underserved communities, especially along public transportation routes. But, you know, kind of to echo sort of what Graham was alluding to, I do believe that the best path forward is home ownership. And I would support, you know, various trade schools, technical skill development, so we can have jobs created in our community where people can afford to live in a house and, you know, start accumulating generational wealth for them and their family.
Thank you
Kim,
so much.
Kim, do I get a chance to answer this question? I haven't had a chance to answer this question.
My sincere apologies. Absolutely, Ms. Silverman.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think it's very simple. We need to have a housing strategy that works for low-income families and doesn't just benefit developers. So three things. The housing authority. We need the housing authority to get back to its mission of building and maintaining housing for those deeply affordable units for our, you know, people making the minimum wage. We need to make sure the trust fund meets the statutory requirements that 50% of the money should go to deeply affordable units. And finally, we need to use the District Opportunity to Purchase Act, which we haven't used. And I think it is a tool. It's a tool that levels the playing field, because right now the developers build the housing they want, not the housing that we need as a city. That's got to change. Thanks for letting me answer the question.
Thank you so much. I am so sorry.
That's okay.
Running over your name. I didn't miss anybody else, right? I think we got everybody in that round. All right, final question. From the district's landmark and nationally renowned Birth to Three law to the recommendations of the Police Reform Commission, the district has some of the most visionary programs and policies in place that our leaders then fail to fully fund or implement. What do you think needs to change in order for our policies and programs like these to actually become reality? Each of you have a 90-second response, and we'll start first with you, Ms. Silverman.
Okay. So putting visionary passing legislation without putting the money behind it and the implementation behind it ends up being sort of an empty gesture. You know, I will use the example of paid family leave, of how I have been able to not just come up with innovative policy, but have the follow through and accountability, and frankly, Kim, just make sure that we're using your taxpayer dollars well. So paid family leave, tough fight, implemented in a pandemic, on time, under budget. And then we looked and said, there's too much money here. So we need to evaluate the fund. And guess what? We increased benefits and cut taxes. That's a fully thought through program that benefits district residents and businesses in our city in general.
Thanks for that. Mr. Hill, how about you?
As I've said once before, one of the things that we definitely need to do, and I showed our government this 4 years ago, 37 states gave our senior citizens no requirement to pay any property on any real property taxes, that was enabled them to transfer their generational wealth on to other family members. Those individuals could pay the regular tax base. The city said back to me that they were going to lose money. I showed them those 37 states also increase their tax base because those new owners of those properties could pay the regular tax rate. And the average rental cost right now in the district is $2,800 a month, for those who don't know. And their ownership tax rate was cheaper than what it costs for you to pay the taxes on those same properties. It is absolutely ridiculous that we have people sitting in these seats that don't consider the investment, the hard work, the time that people have put in to make sure that their family is looked out after they retire or they pass away. And we're stripping it away from them. This is another thing that makes it hard for people to believe they even have a chance in this city. But if they get their heads out of their behind and they stop focusing on what their agenda is and get focused on the agenda of the people, we're going to see the changes that people really want to see in the city. Thank you.
Mr. Marshall.
So everyone, again, I invite you to visit my website, marshallfordc.com, and you can see some of the more thought through details on things I'd like to do. But I love this question because it lets me talk about what I did for 7 years in the district government. I wrote legislation and I wrote regulations. And I approach things a little bit differently than any of our sitting council members. They start with legislation. I say we have to start with coming to you, our employers, our bosses, and getting agreement on what the problem is. We talk to you to define the problem. After we define the problem, then we start talking with stakeholders and we work with the executive to come together on what the possible solution is. And then we come back to you. Does this solution actually work for you? And if we can get your buy-in, if we can convince you that the ideas we came up with are good ideas, then we start writing legislation. But we start with an understanding of what problem we're trying to solve, what the solution actually looks like, and how much it's going to cost, because we're spending your money. So what I can promise you is this: after all that's done, not only will I introduce solid legislation, but I'll make sure it's fully funded from introduction. And I'll also make sure that it's working, because I'll conduct oversight. I'll come to the residents. I won't rely on two hearings every year to get a sense of whether or not the executive wants to tell me whether or not it's working. I'll come talk to you. I'll come to your communities, and we'll have an understanding about how this is actually impacting your life, as opposed to just relying on the filter of television politics.
Mr. McDuffie.
Thank you, Kim. Thank you for the question. The reality is it's about accountability, holding agencies and the people who are supposed to put policy into work and implement it accountable. But the reality is, you know, each person who's running for a position down here is gonna be one of 13. It's really about coalition building and pushing the envelope for the people who need these resources, who need these services, who need council members to deliver. And I have. When I got down to the council, I really pushed to get comprehensive campaign finance reform done and comprehensive ethics reform done. And it wasn't popular with everybody. But I worked with people in the community. I worked with advocacy organizations to get it done. People forget, comprehensive juvenile justice reform was a huge lift, but we worked with dozens of organizations and individuals. People who were in prison, we were connecting with. We were connecting with people in communities to make sure that we built the coalition to get that done. The NEAR Act didn't get funded initially, but we came back and we advocated and we organized and we pushed to get that done. We still have more to go, but that's one of the reasons why I'm running, to make sure that we get the Office of Health Equity and Violence Prevention funded and up to speed. Listen, the REACH Act is transformational. It makes sure we put a racial equity lens on everything we do, both the council and the executive. And we make sure that these bills that are coming through the council get a racial equity impact assessment. That's how we're gonna make sure we're holding people accountable to talk about whether or not this stuff and how it impacts minorities, Black and brown people.
Thank you. Mr. McLaughlin.
I'd first say plus one to Karim. I thought that was a great answer, and I agree with everything he said, maybe even would go a step further with participatory budgeting. But right now, we have the most money per resident of any city in the nation. We have $19.5 billion. Over the last 8 years, when the sitting council members have been in office, we've gone up over $7 billion in our budget. For comparison, that's literally more than the budget of the city of Seattle, just that increase, which has more residents than we do. So the fact that we have these unfunded mandates to me means we're not managing our budget effectively. And so I think we need change is the only answer there. And we need folks who are qualified, who have the history of managing budgets. As I've talked about previously, I manage a large budget. I run a health equity program that serves over 100 million people. I have 20 years of operational and financial management experience. I think we need individuals and leaders who understand how to manage budgets and also who can provide oversight, not with either poisonous relationships and gotcha moments or being absent, but really thinking in a collegial way, but providing still that oversight that's necessary to work together to be able to create both the vision, but also more importantly, the execution that will allow our city to thrive.
Thank you so much for that. Mr. Niosi.
Thank you for the question. I kind of view this as from my project engineering background, there's a multitude of cost, schedule, stakeholder management, and just making sure that projects have quality assurance and return on investment. So to kind of isolate that, one of the things I've been doing when I've been door knocking is coming up with ideas as I've been, talking to the residents of Washington, D.C. And, having a roundtable discussions, I think, is imperative to make sure that the community involvement is at its utmost. But also just recognizing that understanding the scope of work and making sure that we stay within what we're trying to accomplish, I think, is equally as important. And as Graham was saying, we do have a hefty budget in Washington, D.C., and we need to make sure we allocate that fund appropriately across all 8 wards and make sure that there is an emphasis on equity. Thank you.
And then finally, Mr. Schwartzman.
Yes, the REACH Act was mentioned by Kenyan, and I was part of the group to make that possible. Here's a simple statistic which shows the utter failure of trickle-down economics, which has been the agenda, the dominant agenda of our DC government. The life expectancy gap between Black and white residents is shockingly high, and it has actually grown in the last 20 years, not shrunk, grown. This shows the utter disappointment and failure of these trickle-down economic policies to actually reduce and eliminate racial and economic disparities. And I'll give you some visionary implementation, which is in the Green New Deal for DC. And that is a DC public bank that take our money out of Wall Street and use it locally and partner with local banks and credit unions. We power DC, municipalize our utilities instead of sending our payments to profit to CEOs and so on. So those are examples that we more, not the few.
Thank you, Mr. Schwartzman, and thank you to all of you. That was our last and final question of the evening. Again, one more final thank you before I turn it over. Really, I want to say thanks to all of our candidates. It takes so much courage and leadership. We appreciate your willingness to run for this important office during such a critical time in our city and really in our country. We wish you the best as you continue campaigning throughout the district. Stay safe. Thank you for your listening ear to all of our residents. We also thank our hosts, DC for Democracy, and of course, all of you who were our attendees tonight. I also want to remind all of you to take advantage of early voting, which I think begins around October 14th, and all the different ways we have to vote leading up to Election Day on November 8th. Be sure to not just go yourself, take friends, take family. We want to make sure that we have a great turnout for this important election. Alex, I'm going to turn it back over to you, and it has just been my pleasure to join you all as moderator tonight. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Kim, and I'm sure everyone in the chat will join me in expressing our gratitude for your thoughtful moderation and facilitation tonight. Thank you so much for making time and helping us have such a wonderful conversation. Candidates, I know that the campaign trail is hard and long, and I appreciate each of you taking time to be here tonight in the evening to answer these questions and be focused. An hour and a half goes very fast, but I know it takes a lot to answer all of these detailed policy questions. So thank you to each of you. I also want to say thank you to everyone who has joined us as listeners and attendees tonight. The voters of DC are the ones in charge in this moment. So as Kim said, early voting starts in early October, and the decision before you is a really exciting one. DC for Democracy has a lot in store for early voting season, and we'll have more information about that coming soon. But for the immediate next step, we are going to discuss everything that we heard tonight at our next monthly meeting. DC for Democracy's endorsement discussion for this race will be a week from tonight on Wednesday, September 21st, starting at 7 p.m. Everyone is welcome to listen. This is a public conversation that is open to anyone and anyone except the candidates, your core team members, and your family are welcome to speak about what you heard tonight and what you think and any questions that you have. You can register for that community conversation at bit.ly/dc4d-sep. It's terrible reading this out loud. We'll send it by email. And if you're on our mailing list, you'll can get an email about that tomorrow or later this evening, and you can register to join us there. That concludes our program for tonight. Thank you again to everyone for joining us. Stay well, and we'll see you between now and November.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kim, and good luck, everybody.
Yeah, have good a night.
Good night. Thank you, Kim. Thank
likewise. You all. Take care of yourselves.
Have a good night.
Thanks, Kim.
Oh, are you guys going to send us the chat afterwards?
Yes.
Okay, cool, because there was a decent number of questions in there. That wasn't there, so. All right. Thank you. Salute.
Good night, everyone.
I'm not leaving the race.
Hi, I'll see you later. Good night, everyone.